Hi everyone, Darren from DrayTek Australia and New Zealand, and this is one of DrayTek's latest releases, the Vigor2135 series. These are a replacement for the previous 2133 series, which had four models, one of which was a single band 802.11n model, but 802.11n is getting a bit long in the tooth now, so one of the first changes in the 2135 series is no more 802.11n model. If you still have 802.11n devices that you're not ready to upgrade, don't be concerned though, the 802.11ac Wi-Fi models will still work fine with 802.11n devices. Okay, so now we have three models in the new lineup, which on the outside look exactly the same as the old 2133 series. We have the non-wireless Vigor2135, the Vigor2135AC, which features dual band 802.11ac Wi-Fi with up to 400 megabits per second on the 2.4 gigahertz band. That's a step up from the 2133 series already, which only supported up to 300 megabits per second. The 5 gigahertz band supports up to 867 megabits per second, and we also get Wave 2 2x2 MIMO, allowing two simultaneous wireless spatial streams. And then we have the Vigor2135 VAC, which has the same Wi-Fi features, but also includes a built-in analog telephone adapter to allow making VoIP calls using a standard analog telephone handset. In a recent video, I discussed the Vigor2765 series. The 2135 series is very similar. They even look the same on the outside. But the difference is they don't have a built-in ADSL VDSL modem, which means they're not suitable for NBN fiber to the node or fiber to the building connections, which use VDSL. At least not without adding an additional VDSL modem like the Vigor130. But they are perfect for all other types of NBN connections, including fiber to the home, hybrid fiber coaxial, fixed wireless, and satellite connections. If you're not sure what type of NBN connection you have and which router you might need to buy, I'll include a link below to our NBN solutions page, which explains all of that. On the back, we have two USB ports, which can be used to connect a supported 3G or 4G USB modem to provide a backup connection should the primary internet connection fail, or they can be used as the primary connection if LTE is all you can get at your location. Alternatively, the USB ports can be used to connect most standard USB printers or flash drives or USB hard drives for some cheap and easy network attached storage. You can also connect the DrayTek DT201U USB thermometer if you'd like to monitor the device temperature. We have a gigabit Ethernet WAN port and 4 gigabit Ethernet LAN ports. The VoIP model also features two FXS ports that you can plug phones into to make VoIP calls. On Wi-Fi models, we also have a WPS button, which makes connecting Wi-Fi devices securely a bit easier, and we have SMA connectors for our antennas, which allows higher gain antennas to be fitted instead of the standard units if you find you want to extend the Wi-Fi range. DrayTek have the ANT1205 and ANT1207 available, or the directional ANT2520. On the inside is where we see the main improvement over the 2133 series, which is an increase to 600 megabits per second in NAT throughput, up from 500 megabits per second in the 2133 series. We also get 2.1 times faster IPsec throughput and double the SSL VPN throughput. We also get a hardware accelerator, which we didn't have in the 2133 series. That can increase NAT performance up to 940 megabits per second. Okay, let's log into the web user interface. So here we have our usual DrayTek dashboard. I won't go into too much detail here because it's almost identical to the 2765 series I covered just recently. Under IPv4 internet access, we'd see our WAN IP address if we were online and how long it's been up. Under interface, I can see which WAN and LAN ports are active, including the wireless on wireless models, and also if the USB ports are doing anything. Down here under security, we can see how many VPNs are connected, and if I expand out my Vigor, I can see which optional licenses have been activated and when they expire. That includes subscription for the WCF or web content filter, app enforcement license, and the free DRAID DDNS license. On the VoIP model, down the bottom here, we'd also see details for VoIP. Up the top of the main menu, we have the usual quick start wizards to make it easier to get online, set up a VPN client or server, and set up the Wi-Fi on Wi-Fi models. You don't have to use the wizards, they just step you through the process using basic details to make the job easier, but if you're more technically minded, these tasks can be done manually with more detail elsewhere in the menu. Under WAN General Setup, we can configure our WAN ports. We see WAN 1, which is our Gigabit Ethernet WAN port. WAN 3 is the USB port. Wait a sec, where's WAN 2 then? Obviously, there's some shared features with the 2765 series firmware going on here, which does have a WAN 2, which in that case is a configurable LAN WAN Ethernet port. The 2135 series already has an Ethernet WAN, so we don't need that here. If you did need two active Ethernet WANs, you'd need to go for the 2927 series or above. The next thing you might notice is that WAN 1 is set to always on and WAN 3 is set to failover. Some people might want that the other way around and are going to want an LTE connection using a USB modem as their main connection, and maybe not use the Ethernet WAN port at all, or maybe have that as the failover connection. So all we do there is go into WAN 3, change it to always on, and save. After it reboots, we see that now WAN 1 is set to failover and WAN 3 is always on. Okay, so keep in mind that while this series supports two WANs, it can't do load balancing. It can only fail over to a second WAN if the primary one drops out. If you need load balancing, that is having two WANs active simultaneously, check out the Vigor2927, 2962, or the Vigor3910, which can load balance up to 8 WANs. WAN Internet Access is where we enter our ISP details for each WAN. LAN General Setup is where we can change our local IP address range, and we can have up to 2 subnets. That second subnet is grayed out at the moment, and we enable that down here under VLANs. So we see here we can have up to 8 VLANs, which can be either port-based or tag-based. Okay, so let's enable those and apply all of our LAN ports to VLAN 0, just for an example, and all of our Wi-Fi SSIDs to VLAN 1, and apply those to LAN 2. Once it reboots, if I check back in LAN General Setup, the second subnet, LAN 2, is now enabled. Details page on either of those allows us to alter the DHCP details, or maybe disable DHCP completely if you have a reason to do that. Bind IP to MAC allows reserving IP addresses in the DHCP pool to particular devices. LAN port mirroring is featured, which is useful for troubleshooting certain situations. NAT is where we can set up any port forwarding rules we might need. I'll include a link to a recent webinar on this topic which discusses the differences between port redirection, DMZ, open ports, port triggering, and ALG. Here's where we can enable or disable the hardware acceleration feature, allowing us to boost NAT performance up to 940 megabits per second from the standard max of 600 megabits per second. If you'd like more information about what hardware acceleration is and how it works, I'll include a link below to our recent webinar talking about new product releases in 2020. Hardware acceleration is discussed around the 6.5 minute mark. The firewall is object-based, and down here under Object Settings is where we create the objects. CSM Content Security Management is where we can set up filters to block or allow certain content. Bandwidth management, we can set session or bandwidth limits and alter the QoS settings. Under App QoS, we can select applications we want to prioritize with a single click. VPN and remote access, just like the 2765 series, the 2135 series supports two simultaneous VPNs. If I go to remote dial-in user or LAN to LAN, we can set up to 32 profiles of each, but only two will be able to connect at once. That would normally be more than enough for the standard home or small business that these routers are aimed at, where you might want to connect to a head office network with a LAN-to-LAN VPN to access the head office resources. In the Wi-Fi models, next we have the 2.4 GHz and 5 GHz Wi-Fi settings. Let's take a quick look at a couple of these. Under General Setup, we can alter the mode. Mixed mode allows connection from older Wi-Fi clients, including 11B, 11G+, and 11N. Next, we can change the radio channel. Auto is usually the way to go if you're not sure which channel is the best to pick, but if you prefer to pick a channel manually, a handy feature is AP discovery down here. If I hit scan, it'll find any other Wi-Fi broadcasts in the vicinity, so I can then choose a radio channel that isn't being used by any of my neighbours, so we don't compete with each other and lose performance and or range. So here we see channels 1, 4, 5 and 6 have fairly strong signals, so they must be fairly close to me. Above channel 6 we're only seeing weak signals and there's nothing coming up on channels 8, 9 or 10. A good bet then would be to take channel 9 in this case, which is right in the middle of that gap and therefore the least likely to be affected by any overlapping signals. Next we have 4 SSIDs, which is handy if you want to run a guest network to give visitors internet access but keep them out of your local network. WPS, if you've got your router stashed away somewhere where it isn't easy to get to, or you're too lazy to get up and go to it, instead of pushing the WPS button on the back, you can do the same thing here by clicking on Start PBC. The router is now waiting for any WPS requests from wireless clients. Airtime fairness allocates bandwidth by time instead of speed, so faster wireless devices aren't penalised as much by slower ones on the network. The triggering client number is the number of wireless devices you want to connect before it starts doing its thing. And band steering will automatically search for wireless devices on the network that are capable of using the 5 GHz band and force them to use that, so that devices that can only do 2.4 GHz get a greater share of the bandwidth and everyone is happy. If you'd like to learn more about airtime fairness and band steering, I'll include a link to another video in the description below. System maintenance is where we go to reboot, backup or upgrade firmware amongst other things. Diagnostics has a bunch of tools for troubleshooting. And under central management, we can manage up to 2 Vigor APs. The Vigor2135 series can also be managed using the Vigor ACS2 or Vigor ACS3 central management applications. So that is DrayTek's Vigor2135 series routers, which come with a 2-year back-to-base warranty. For more information about all DrayTek products, please check out our website at www.draytek.com.au. If you have any questions, please comment below or send an email to sales@draytek.com.au or just give us a call on 02983888899. As usual, I have links in the description below to the Vigor2135 series product page and to a test drive of the web user interface if you'd like to browse some of those other options, and I also have links to the other information I mentioned. Please like and subscribe below, give the bell a click too if you'd like a notification of new videos as we put them up. Thanks and bye for now.